Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. On this episode of Insight, fateful decisions, how that one choice can change the course of your life.
My father decided to dress me up as a boy. I had a lot of freedom. I had two sisters who didn't have the same kind of opportunities as I did.
I decided to let my hair out and just be an afro. I had a lot of unexpected positive consequences. Ended up being in a bonds campaign.
You're better off going to the grave going, did I really do that? Instead of saying, gee, I wish I would have done that.
How did you make those decisions?
Oh, it's probably a bit stupid.
Laura. Would you marry me?
Oh. Allow me to introduce myself. My name's Jerry Gelch. The experience that I've gained over the years, thousands and thousands of hours of landing and taking off on the beach on Fraser Island, is priceless. G'day. In the aviation industry, every pilot, whether you're flying a small two-seater aircraft or a 350-seat aircraft, pilots must make decisions on a daily basis. Every pilot in every aircraft has a checklist, which we have to rehearse time and time again, just like muscle memory. But of course, there's always going to be something out of the blue. Let's roll back to 2000. The pilot who owned the aircraft was actually taking me for a test flight to see whether I wanted to buy it or not. Got airborne. Both engines cut out. At one point, it looked like we were going to hit a huge drain about 6 metres deep. That was going to kill us. He actually froze. The aeroplane was going to crash. I wasn't going to die that day. I took over and tried to save it. Didn't happen. Speared it into the ground. Fortunately, after impact, I was still alive, although I had huge chest injury from the control column, huge facial and head injuries, and of course, fractured vertebrae in the spine as well. I must admit, I do put myself in a lot of situations which most people would not. But flying, it's in my blood. Why would you want to give up something you so dearly love?
Jerry, you decided to take control that day and it took you 14 months to recover from that crash. How long after were you back in the air?
I'm not quite sure how long I spent in hospital because I was in on life support and ICU and then shipped to Brisbane. And when I got out, it was a long drive from Brisbane back to Hervey Bay and on the floor of a car because I was all broken up. And the next day, I threw one of my senior pilots in the co-pilot seat, took the aeroplane for a fly, straight away, just to get that monkey off my back. They got to 500 feet, I pulled the engine off to cut the engine and to do a false landing, and then come back and did a false landing back on the runway just to go, right, it's done. Okay, I can move on from here.
Wow.
Yeah.
You've been flying planes for more than three decades. Mm-hmm. When you're in emergency situations, is every decision you make conscious?
No, not every decision. A lot of it because of so much training that is done in the aviation industry. When you've done so much training, it's just automatic. You just go into damage control and you do it. That's part of it. So muscle memory does take a lot of it away, but also you do have to make conscious decisions because things change every nanosecond, you know, in an emergency situation.
So that muscle memory, is it like a sort of feeling?
There's no feeling at all. It just happens. It just rolls off your hands. You know, bang, 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 bang. This is done. Okay, we're in trouble here. We do this, we do that. And you don't even think about it. It's just muscle memory takes over. But then when something pops up and you think, oh, we better think about that one. That's when the brain kicks back in, you start taking back over again. That's when you really got to start making decisions that, you know, that's life-saving decisions.
So when you talk about that switch, is that a bit like a sort of gut feeling, intuition?
Yes, it is. You know, especially when you can see it all unfolding in front of you, and there's something going horribly wrong, and you've got to make an instant decision.
Joel, I can see you wanting to have a big chat here to Jerry. You've studied intuition in decision making. What is intuition?
Well, I think the best definition is a learnt, productive use of unconscious information. And what it is, it's tapping into unconscious information. So a lot, some would say the majority of information in our brains is unconscious. And so that unconscious information can become associated with things in the world. So people might have heard of, you know, classical conditioning or Pavlov's dogs, right? Learning. So your brain associates information with positive or negative things. Maybe the plane's going to go up, maybe it's going to go down. So your brain learns that. It all can happen unconsciously. So when you're in that situation, you can end up feeling it. And that's why people call it this gut response. Some people feel it in the chest, the fingertips. So you're feeling that unconscious information. And that basically lets you tap into it, lets you sort of use that extra information to make better decisions, faster decisions, in typically urgent situations.
Samia, you hitchhiked a lot as a teenager. There was one particularly fateful ride. Tell us about that.
There was no buses and I didn't have a car. And a pink Mercedes came over the hill and picked me up. And we went back to the house I was in and they were travelling north to Cairns, so this was from the Sunshine Coast, which was just a dirt road in those days. And I left a kitchen table that said I'll be gone for 2 weeks and then I'll be back, and jumped in the car and we drove to Cairns.
Wow, just like that, you're 19, jump in a car, head north.
Pretty much, yep.
What was life like at the time?
It was very in the moment, following what sort of came along. We were all quite young. And just kind of going day to day, really.
How did you feel about the world itself?
I was actually looking for my mother. I was adopted, so I had this idea that she was in Queensland, and I felt like I wanted to see more of the world and outside of a fairly small, kind of strict environment that I'd grown up in. It was just an adventure, really.
And did you come back in 2 weeks?
No. It was much longer than 2 weeks.
Tell us what happened.
So we got to Cairns and we stayed at a youth hostel, and then a guy came and knocked on the door and he said, I'm looking for crew to get on a boat. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. And the person I was with, whose car it was, came back and I said, oh, do you want to jump on a boat? And we went down to the yacht club and met this sort of, I'd describe him as slightly mad German who had a small ketch. And we jumped on and we sailed from Cairns to Darwin. And then we got off in Darwin and met a mad French Algerian who had a catamaran that was 32 foot, and then ended up crewing on that. Neither of us knew how to sail. We learnt, and they're quite small boats and there was no radio or internet or equipment really, and ended up sailing to India.
What did you know about this man?
Not much, because I didn't speak French. He spoke English a little bit. You know, you're on a boat, it's in the middle of the ocean. We communicated in other ways. I fell in love.
Did you know his name?
I knew his first name, Jean.
Jean. What compelled you to go on that boat?
By then I'd been captivated by the ocean. I was completely hooked by salt water and wind and sails and catching fish and dolphins and phosphorescence and all the things that the ocean gives you. And we'd had a lot of Tahitian rice wine the night before.
Always does it.
It always does it. And it was as simple as, we're looking for crew, do you want to come on this boat?
You spontaneously accepted an offer to travel to Cairns. Then you sailed away with a man you'd just met. How did you make those decisions?
Oh, it's probably a bit stupid. And young, very young. I mean, 19. And I think it just seemed like an adventure. It was like, OK, let's do this, let's see the world. I don't think I had a sense of danger. I didn't feel any threat from the people around me. It felt quite warm and friendly and like a family.
Rahila, you grew up in Afghanistan. Were there different ways that boys and girls were treated?
Definitely, yes. The rights that are afforded to boys are not afforded to girls. The right to education, the right to freedom, all of those things are not afforded to girls.
When you were 2 years old, your father made a fateful decision. What was that?
My father made two fateful decisions, the one being he decided to dress me up as a boy. And the second one was for him to seek asylum in Australia.
So he cut your hair and put you in boys' clothing?
That's correct, yeah, completely dressed up as a boy. Yeah, no one really knew that I was a girl.
How did that affect your childhood?
Significantly. I was definitely treated differently by my community. I had a lot of freedom. I did a lot of things that my brother did. I had two sisters who didn't have the same kind of opportunities as I did. Dressing up as a boy definitely impacted my ability to go out in the community and do whatever little boys did.
You and your family joined your father in Australia when you were nine. Mm-hmm. Did you continue to dress as a boy?
I did, yes. Came to Australia dressing up as a boy, and then probably when I was 10, the school had quite a lot of issues, obviously, with how they were going to manage me and, for example, what toilets I would use and things like that. So I would use the teacher's toilets.
Did anyone ever say to you, you should dress as a girl?
People did. People used to tease me and my mum and say, you know, what are you going to do when you hit puberty? And I would have complete tantrums and say, I'm not going to dress up as a girl. And this wasn't a gender dysphoria or anything like that. It was just simply that I felt more confident, more comfortable dressing up as a boy. And the more I think about it now, I guess at that age, I probably didn't know it at the forefront of my mind. But maybe that was because I knew the limitations that a girl had, and I didn't want those limitations. I did not want to wear a scarf. I did not want to stay in the home. I wanted to be out on the streets playing with my brother.
Did you see those limitations in your two sisters?
Definitely, yeah. So my two sisters are older than me. Yeah, they were in the home. They helped my mum cook and clean, whereas me and my brother, we just did whatever we wanted to do.
Joel, you're a professor of cognitive neuroscience. What factors affect how we make decisions?
I mean, the state we're in is probably up there at the top of the list, right? If you're sad, if you're happy, if you're anxious, that's going to affect things. The decision itself, what it's about, whether it's, you know, tea or coffee versus getting a divorce or marrying or buying a house, that changes things, right? And that's going to change your emotion, your emotional state by how big the decision is. The context, I mean, age there would be another one as well, right? A young child, the brain changes rapidly through the teen years. It really doesn't solidify. The frontal cortex doesn't lock in until midway through the 20s, and then things change. So age is a big one as well.
Bruce, more than 20 years ago, you were diagnosed with an early form of esophageal cancer. What was life like before your diagnosis?
I had pretty much a fantastic life. I was born on the beach. I worked on the beach. My whole life revolved around the ocean. I had three young children, three sons, happily married. And I thought the world was pretty well set out for me. And in 2000, I decided to be a bit like the Beverly Hillbillies and packed up the lot, and we moved to Noosa to live. Supposedly lived the idyllic lifestyle. I had employment there and everything seemed like it was going to be great. And a year to the day that I was there, I had a bit of a cough and I went to a local doctor and she sent me down to Brisbane for some tests where I was rapidly, at the PA hospital, I was rapidly diagnosed with stage 2/3 esophageal cancer.
And what did that mean, stage 2 or stage 3?
It's a death sentence. They offered me a trial. They wanted to put me on a trial that was unproven. And they said, if we don't put you on the trial and you live your life, you will die in less, maybe 18 months.
What was the percentage of survival without the trial?
At that stage, it was 3%.
3%.
It was a known fact, 3%. Very few people survived the operation itself. And if they did survive, it was a 5-year limit. And of the 5 years, only 3% lived.
And the trial, did they know how that might turn out?
I think they had ideas, but the shock came for me was they said, we have only a certain amount of people who can come on this trial. We've picked you out, but we're only going to give you an hour to decide. I had to make up my mind there and then.
And what did you decide?
Well, I had two choices, of course. So I took a punt. I took the biggest punt of my life. And I went with a group of men that I'd never met before. I trusted them with my life.
So you decided to go on the trial?
Yes, I did.
How did you weigh up that decision in an hour?
It was difficult for sure. Not many people are faced with a thing like that. I chose to be, because I'm a spontaneous sort of a person, this is it. And we're all up front from the word go.
Were you thinking about that 3%?
I thought, well, 3% is better than none. You know, when you talk about it, here's the odds. It wasn't good. Single figures are never are good. But I decided that I had no other choice. I knew what the outcome was if I went one way, and this way was unknown.
You're here with us today, so you were obviously in that 3%. What do you attribute that to?
Positive thinking. People have asked me, my surgeon and a couple of people at the hospital asked me, do you think religion played a part in your ongoing success? And I said, no, not really. It was a spontaneous decision, and that's what I chose.
Joel, if we have ownership over our decisions, does that affect outcomes?
Yes, it can affect a lot of things. So there's really interesting experiments. So when we voluntarily choose to exercise, you get all these great health benefits, right? Cardiovascular, mental health, all kinds of things. You can compare that to being sort of forced to do the same amount of exercise. So physically it's the same, but there's no choice there. It's involuntary. And a lot of those effects go away. And in fact, it becomes stressful. So taking away that choice there in that situation, that experiment, is a real negative.
Adam, you're vegan. What made you decide to stop using animal products?
In about 2015, it was around the time that Facebook started also auto-playing ads and auto-playing videos. And it just so happened that across my feed, a pretty graphic, you know, short 30-second video appeared. I watched it and it kind of gave me a bit of a shock. At the time, I was teaching university and I had two students that happened to be vegan as well. And they pointed me in the direction of a couple of documentaries as well if I wanted to go down that avenue and explore what that was going to be. And I don't think I made it through the first video before I made the decision to be vegan.
Was it a tough decision?
No, it was like a light switch. I'd seen what I'd seen, and for me that was the decision right there and then, and I've been vegan since.
You were engaged at the time. How did your decision impact your relationship?
Yeah, so I went vegan essentially overnight. My partner did not take the same journey with me. And so there was definitely conversation, good conversation and not so good conversation, disagreements and questions about morality and how we both saw the world now. And so there was a bit of tension there, definitely.
What were some of the conversations about?
One in particular was how we planned on raising our future children. I've always wanted children and so did she, and I thought it was the right decision to raise our children vegan, and then when they were old enough to decide to eat animal products, they could make that decision. But she felt very much against that. She felt it was something that they were and should be able to do from the get-go. And we disagreed there.
You got married. Did your wife end up becoming vegan as well?
We did get married, and no, she didn't.
What did that decision cost you?
In the end, it ended up costing me my marriage. It costed me a lot of relationships, that her family and all of that. But I ended up gaining, like, so much more as a result of that decision. So positive.
What would you say you gained?
I gained self-advocacy, I think, in being able to be my own person, make my own decisions and stand up for what I believed in. that was a really tricky thing to do. It wasn't easy, but I've stood by being vegan my whole life, and it's wonderful. I've only had good things come of it.
Jerry, what are the odds of being in a plane crash?
Very rare compared to other accidents, like motor accidents and industrial accidents and things like that. It is, the percentage is very, very low.
What kind of luck have you had with cars?
Cars? I used to race cars as well, you know, Queensland Sports Car Series. I was top five and, you know, for years and years and years. And, you know, we're talking very high horsepower, very light cars with no roofs and things like that. And I've managed to roll one over quite significantly twice in two different times. You know. Same with on the road, motorcycle accidents when I was young, you know, cars pulling out in front of me, hitting them and going too fast and stuff. But I always seem to get up and shake myself off and keep going.
Any other close calls?
Oh, yeah. Well, you also know that I'm a free climber and a free diver and a spear fisherman. And I've had a very, very large argument with a very large tiger shark over a fish up off Cairns one time. And it's but anyway, he won the argument, so I was quite happy to back off, yeah.
Joel, could intuition be a factor here, or is Jerry just lucky?
Oh, I mean, it sounds like the aircraft example, the crash, I mean, intuition probably played a role there, right? So it's a time-limited situation. He hasn't got very long to react, and he's had the training, so he has the muscle memory, like you talked about, but also we don't have time to logically and rationally, consciously go through option A, option B, right? And so in that unusual situation, he's got to make a decision very quickly.
Was the trip smooth sailing?
Well, we left at the beginning of cyclone season and we hit a cyclone. We ended up lost in the ocean for weeks and weeks, going around in circles. The boat broke open underneath.
I actually had guilt for not killing someone.
I felt like I sent them to their demise in a way.
What is guilt?
I started an affair with this man.
Guilt is one of those things that you can't just say you don't deserve it and it goes off. It just lingers, and seeing it linger and affect someone so much just really hurts you internally and physically.
Samir, at 19, you decided to sail towards India with a man you'd just met. Was the trip smooth sailing?
At the beginning, and then very quickly not.
What started to happen?
Well, we left at the beginning of cyclone season, which is kind of a silly thing to do, and we hit a cyclone. So we ended up lost in the ocean for weeks and weeks, going around in circles, and the boat broke open. Underneath. We had our passports around our necks ready to get in a dinghy and take our chances. So, yeah, that was pretty scary.
What was your relationship with Jean like?
We'd fallen in love.
And how did your relationship with him evolve?
Over time, I started to feel like there was more going on than I was aware of, and little hints of things started to emerge. So I started having some doubts about who I was with and if I actually was safe.
What did you come to learn about the man you were travelling with?
Well, that he'd been in a number of wars around the world, and that at that point he had changed, I thought. Like, that was the impression, that was something he didn't want to be a part of anymore. And then at a certain point, I realised that he'd hijacked a plane, and I was a bit confused about what that was all about. And he didn't have the name that I thought he had. So I started to really feel quite confused, and I think a bit in denial. I didn't really want to know, and I felt like I shouldn't ask as well. There was a sense of danger starting to kind of emerge. But, you know, we're stuck on a boat in the middle of the ocean, so it's not like I could go, OK, I think I'll just go down the shop and phone my best friend. It was like, I'm not quite sure what I should do here. I can't really jump over and swim to shore, you know?
Did you ever find out what his job was?
He grew up in Algeria and during a big civil war when he was very young. He'd been a soldier and then what they called in the French Foreign Legion and then a mercenary as well, which is something I didn't know about. Yeah. I didn't know all the reasons, but I knew at a certain point that Interpol was after him and that there'd been a bank robbery at some point as well. So there was sort of a big mix of things going on that I was having trouble making sense of. Yeah.
Wow. After more than a year, you came to a crossroads. What decision were you faced with then?
So by then we were living on the border of China and in the Himalayas, so Nanda Devi, which is the biggest, second biggest mountain on the Indian side, and in a very remote, really remote area. And I contracted cholera and we were a long way from hospitals and so I was sick for a very long time and very fortunate that I lived. But there was a certain point where a journalist from the Paris Match had come to interview Jean because people thought he was dead and he disappeared. I didn't know this was happening and left me and went to Delhi, which was 300 kilometres away. And then he came back and the Baba and Didi, whose property we were living on, came and they said, you know, she should go home. She should go back to her own country. And there was this distinct moment of them looking at me, particularly Didi, and going, do you want to go home? And in that moment, I knew that if I didn't go home, I was going to die.
Wow.
And I also knew that Jean didn't want me to go.
So that was a big moment for you?
Absolutely.
What did you decide to do?
I said, yeah, I want to go. I want to go home.
You returned to Australia. What was life like for you back home?
It was very strange. I'd been extremely ill and I still was quite ill. And I couldn't explain to anyone what had happened. I mean, how do you explain that you've been with someone, that you've been in a cyclone? We actually had pirates attack us at one point. Like, so I'd seen a lot and had been with someone who hijacked a plane and robbed banks and... How do you say to your 19, 20-year-old, 22-year-old friends who've been eating mangoes and surfing at Noosa Heads?
Yeah. Rahila, when you were a child, your father decided to dress you as a boy. Years later, you made a decision for yourself. What was that?
Yep, so at the age of 10, I decided that I was ready to dress up as a girl again.
Do you remember kind of why you wanted to do that?
I kind of knew that girls in Australia didn't have any limitations like they did back in Afghanistan. So I guess I probably saw that there was no difficulty if I did dress up as a girl, that I could continue to live my life the way that I wanted to.
And in terms of dressing up as a girl, did that mean you changed your clothes, you changed your hair?
Yeah. So I actually came home one day from school and I said to my parents, I want to play with a doll. So they did. They bought me a doll. And slowly I let my hair grow out and started wearing girls' clothes.
You made another big decision in Year 11. What was that?
Yes. Yeah, so in Year 11 I was struggling quite a lot with my identity and I wanted to explore who I was as a person. So I started researching and becoming quite religious. My parents are Muslim and I decided to explore that a little bit more and decided to wear a scarf and really practice my religion.
So you wore hijab. Are you still religious today?
No, I did a lot of research and I would say probably second year of uni, I decided that it was not for me. I did not feel very confident. I had researched as much as I could and didn't feel that I could fit in. As a Muslim woman, I did not feel that I had... I didn't feel that it gave me the liberty that I thought it did, and I know it does give quite the sense of freedom for a lot of Muslim women out there, but for me it just did not.
You said you lost your confidence. Did you get that back?
I did, yeah. So second year of uni, I decided one day I was sitting in the car waiting to go to a lecture and I said, I'm going to take my hijab off. This is the day. And I literally took it off, left it in the car and went to my lecture.
And how did you feel?
Oh, liberated.
You're no longer guided by religion. What is it that influences your decisions today?
I think it's just the freedom of choice, the freedom to decide whatever I want to decide for my life, live with the values that I want to live with. I'm now married to an Irish-Italian man, and we're kind of just figuring it out and seeing what our values are, what our morals are.
Faustina, your mother is Chinese-Malaysian and your father is Ghanaian. You grew up in Australia and you were given a nickname at school. What were you called?
So the nickname originally was Fuzzball and I was named by my two best friends in primary school, Natalia and Florian, and then that changed over to Fuzzy over time.
How did that make you feel when you were called Fuzzy?
It made me feel cool, I guess, and special in a way. It definitely wasn't isolating at all. But it was because in grade five, us ethnic kids had figured out, oh, in Australia, Aussies seem to call each other nicknames or like shorten their names or name each other based off a feature. And so I was anointed Fuzzball/Fuzzy.
Because of your hair?
Because of my hair.
Okay. So you didn't feel like it was isolating. It was like a cool thing.
Yeah, it was fun.
What was high school like for you?
High school was not fun.
Okay.
Entering high school, those first kind of year or two, it just was very strict, very punitive Catholic girls' school. I didn't feel like it was warm or inviting at all. Some of the rules were around like how my hair needed to be presented. One of the things that entering into high school with my single parent, my mum, was that we wanted to braid my hair into multiple braids. And that's a protective hairstyle in African hair. And it allows the liberation of my mum who was working, you know, night shift at the hospital, to just do my hair for a set number of hours so that I could just focus on school and mum could focus on work for a number of weeks until we needed to just redo it again. But my school saw that as an extravagant hairstyle and something which I could be suspended for. And it just felt extremely isolating. I didn't enjoy it at all. And that was a part of a series of reasons as to why I skipped school a lot and I stayed at home. I pretended to be sick to my Chinese grandparents and ended up just watching Oprah Winfrey on TV every afternoon.
Sounds great.
Yeah, I know, right?
What did you decide once you finished school?
I decided to let my hair out and just be an afro. I was just like, F this. I've spent so many years being told how my hair should be presented, and I felt so much inspiration, like in the pop music world. You know, you had Mel B from the Spice Girls with their hair out. You had Whoopi Goldberg at times in Sister Act with her hair out. And I wanted to be that woman. I just wanted to just express myself in that way. And, you know, that's my natural hair. I just wanted it to be out.
Did the decision to embrace your natural hair have any unexpected consequences?
It did. It had a lot of unexpected positive consequences. So I, during uni, decided to fly to Sydney to try and get a job in television, and I took a bit of a detour seeing casting agents to just try and get some work, like, you know, as an extra or something. And then a casting agent was like, oh my gosh, I need to send you to a modelling agency. She drove me off to a modelling agency in Potts Point. I eventually get signed by Chic Management at the time, and within a week I get like a text message on my Nokia phone about a Bonds casting. Ended up being in a Bonds campaign.
Wow.
Wild.
Do you think you would have been in that campaign had you braided your hair, tamed it, straightened it?
Right, yeah, no. Yeah. I think the afro really set it off.
Laura, like Adam, you're also vegan. Have you had to ever defend your decision?
Absolutely. People hate vegans.
Really?
Yes, argue with vegans all the time. I've been vegan for 9 years, so I've met a lot of people who've tried to argue with me.
Can you give us an example?
Absolutely. When I was at university, I helped to run the vegan club there. So there was a lot of setting up stalls and having people sign up for the club and giving out cupcakes. And at least once a day, someone would come up and just argue with me and say all these ridiculous arguments against veganism. And then after a while of arguing with people, I just got over it and I started to have fun with it. So now when someone tries to argue with me, I just think, well, you're not going to go vegan. You don't want to listen to anything I have to say. So how far will you go to defend eating animals? And will you agree to eat a dog? Oh. And so many people will.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
I don't think they would really eat a dog. They just say that to argue with me.
Adam visited your stall at uni, Laura. What did you initially think of him?
Oh, I was very excited when he walked up to the stall because he's quite handsome and he's not what I didn't think he was vegan. I thought he was a first year and he was coming up to argue with me and nobody had argued with me that day. So I was like, yes, is he going to eat a dog?
You were ready for a fight?
I was so ready for a fight. And he walked up and he disappointed me so badly. He walked up and he goes, how do I join? So it turns out, no, he would not eat a dog.
What ended up happening?
We got to know each other over probably quite a while, about a year. We didn't know each other that well to begin with and then we got to know each other a lot better. We started dating and it's many years down the line now. We have 4 kids and 2 cats and we own a house.
So would you thank veganism for this union?
Definitely.
Are your children vegan?
They are. And they have been since they were little.
Bruce, more than 20 years ago, you decided to take a chance on a medical trial for your terminal cancer. What were the consequences of that decision that you made in 1 hour?
It changed the way I thought about my life, my vulnerability and the vulnerability of those around me. I actually embarked on a life of even busier life than what I had. It encouraged me to live life to the fullest, sometimes a little bit foolishly. And I rode motorcycles, I did all that crazy stuff. But I embraced a life of no fear. Nothing frightened me, and still doesn't to this day. If a storm's going to come up and we've got a cyclone or there's something happening or a giant fire or something like that where we live, it doesn't bother me. I instill that sort of stuff on my children, my boys who are adults, but the risks in life I don't take really, but I'm not afraid of anything.
And your operation was part of a medical trial?
Yes. They carried this on as a regular thing. They expanded and expanded. I believe I am the oldest surviving esophageal cancer patient in Australia at the moment.
So a psychic is a professional. They can understand the past and give insight about the past, but they can also accurately predict future life events in someone's current life path.
Joel, do you believe psychics can help us make the right choices? Celine, when you make big decisions, where do you turn?
I feel like I tend to turn a lot inward. I mean, when you're asking people around you for any sort of advice, or I think a lot of the time people tend to have bias, you know, when they know you and they speak from their own kind of experiences about maybe what they believe that might be best for you, but it can be a bit daunting to make decisions. I kind of found myself exploring the idea of speaking with a psychic, and I tried a few different ones, just kind of seeing and testing if that gave me clarity, and I feel like it did.
What kind of decisions are we talking about here?
I think decisions where the consequences feel like if I was to decide the wrong thing, it could maybe even, I feel like, put me on a different path, which I tend to think is that the right path for me. So things that I've asked about was more about my career, you know, relationships around me.
How reliable are psychics in your experience?
Because I guess I've been to a few. I mean, I think it's like anything, you have to kind of make that judgment that you can't just really follow anything blindly. It's still your life that you're taking control and accountability of yourself. I just kind of feel like when you do get that advice, if it resonates with you and you know that it's correct and it feels like it's right as well and it's backing up what you kind of already felt, then I've kind of always followed that and that's helped me. And anytime the information's really vague and I'm like, that doesn't sound right, then yeah. But I do think they're reliable, yeah.
You were conflicted about accepting a job offer. A psychic advised you turn it down. What did you do?
So I thought I'd probably get a second opinion, and I kind of saw an opportunity to get a second opinion and I thought, oh, I better take a chance. And yeah.
You saw a second psychic, Kale. What did Kale tell you?
He said that a spirit had been trying to pull me into it for a while, and they'd been trying to get me to take it. When he said, you know, that, like, I'd been being guided to it, he was like, take it. It's a good decision to take it for you.
Yeah. Kale, you're Celine's psychic. What does a psychic do?
So a psychic is a professional. They have a strong intuition, so they can understand the past and give insight about the past, but they can also accurately predict future life events in someone's current life path.
You started on TikTok. Yeah. Here's one of your online readings.
Your auntie say you stopped studying security.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's what I wanted to do. I was in the middle of it and then I stopped.
Is there any way that I would know that? You never put anything on social media about being security? So now you know it's your auntie's.
What was going on in that session? What are you seeing?
Well, generally when somebody comes to me, they are distracted. Human beings get very distracted on what we are pursuing in our life. And so clients come and they're distracted in life, and I'm able to see not just the future but the past. And so I was able to see with my intuition that she studied security, and I never met her, she never gave me her name, and I saw that she was enrolled in security, and I said to her that your guides, her aunties, are asking her to go back to security. And that's what was happening in the session.
Is it possible to explain sort of what goes on in your mind?
Yeah, so the way that I describe it to people is everybody here is able to remember where the microwave is in their kitchen. And just in a second ago, you quickly saw a flash of it. So as a psychic, I have that as a way to see the past and the future. So it's that vague, but I see just the way you saw your microwave, the way I see the past and the future.
What decisions are most clients grappling with?
Well, there's usually the big four. So it's fertility, finances, career, and love.
And why do you think people come to you for such big life decisions?
I think that people get overwhelmed with life, and I think that they want to make decisions and use the best time they have here on life making decisions from right intentions. And people have a fear of making mistakes. And so they want to be informed.
Have you ever got anything wrong?
Not to my knowledge that I can think of. I can't think of the last time I didn't make a prediction that was wrong.
Joel, do you believe psychics can help us make the right choices?
Interesting question. Yeah, I think everyone can help anyone make a decision, right? So we're social beings, and talking to people can often give you a different and new perspective. In that situation, I would also add in the extra thing that, you know, there is a sort of responsibility there that if people are going to take anything you say very strongly and take what you say or do what you say, then there is a responsibility there that's worth, yeah, thinking about.
Kale, how do you feel about that responsibility aspect?
I think that I have a duty of care and I have a code of ethics, and clients who come to see me sign a contract. And so I do believe that I have a responsibility to make sure that I deliver information with honesty, and that's how I remain accurate, by telling the truth.
Joel, when we're making decisions, how much choice do we really have?
That's the million-dollar question, right? So this is the free will question. So I think a good way to approach this is to zoom out, right? And we can think from, you know, first, we're not talking about, you know, physics and quantum mechanics, that kind of thing. Let's just talk about biology and being human, right? So from our genetics through to the hormones and vitamins in the womb, these kinds of things are already changing and making us who we are, right? And then our early childhood, education, all these things layer on. And you can think about each one of those things removing choice or removing free will, right? And then we go right up to this moment in time. And then there are things like being in the supermarket, right? Nudges and the things that companies do on websites, which will affect our decisions, and we have no idea they're doing that, right? Everything at eye level is what we tend to buy. We have a big bias for that. We don't know we're being sort of nudged. We don't know our behaviour is being influenced, but it is.
What do you think about free will?
Yeah, which is kind of, from one point of view, maybe it doesn't matter because we feel like we have free will, right? There's a strong illusion there. So you can say, well, it doesn't matter. Like, we don't know when we're being primed or biased on websites or in the supermarket. We can't feel it, so it doesn't matter. We still feel like we have choice.
I'm going to think very differently when I choose stuff in the supermarket now. Celine, do you believe in fate or free will?
For me, I believe in both. I think that fate is there. I think that there are things that would be predetermined. But I do think, obviously, when we come here, you know, we're having a human experience and we have choice. I feel like they both play a part.
Yeah. How about you, Faustina? Do you believe in fate or free will?
I think both things can coexist at the same time, and we're informed in life and attracted to the things that we're attracted to and drawn to those things. I also think about luck a lot. And there was this really cool thing that an entrepreneur had once said on a podcast, and he said, you know, each day you have the opportunity to create luck for yourself each and every day. And I feel like, similarly, I'm making decisions in my life that can give me that sort of good luck each and every day. Yeah.
Bruce, did fate play a role in your survival?
Yes, absolutely. When I first went to Noosa to live, I attended a couple of business meetings. I met a guy who had the same experience as myself. He had been diagnosed with esophageal cancer. And I said to him, I've just been diagnosed. He said, well, you must go and see this guy down in Brisbane. Now, had I not been at that meeting and met that guy, I would not be sitting here now. The other point of it was, if you go back, what brought me to Noosa? If I hadn't gone to Noosa to live in 2000, I would never have met that guy who put me onto the doctor, who changed my whole life.
What does your wife say about that moment?
Well, I don't think it was one of those moments where everyone says, oh, fantastic, or anything like that. I think there was a sigh of relief when we saw a door open. She was very unsure, having three young boys to look after, especially on her own. But there was a ray of hope. One way there wasn't a ray, there was nothing. The other side, the 3% side, said there was a ray of hope. So she went along and supported me 100%.
Does she believe everything happens for a reason?
She says, if it's meant to be, it's meant to be. No, I think she just said, aren't we the luckiest people? Yeah. And that was it. Yeah, absolutely.
Samia, a decision you made at 19 changed your life. Do you ever wonder what your world might look like now had you not accepted that ride, had you not got on that boat?
I wouldn't be the same person, you know, in retrospect, oh, if I hadn't done that, maybe this would have happened. But we end up where we end up regardless, I think. And I do think that there is free will in terms of that. I had an Aikido teacher and he used to hold his hand up and he'd say, healing hand, killing hand, same hand, your choice. Mm. And I think that we do have that choice and that we are connected, you know, to everyone and everything. We just sometimes don't see that connection.
Any regrets?
I don't think you can, I don't think I can regret things because that's, it's done. You know, it's already been done. So, no, I don't think I have regrets. I think I learnt a lot about humanity. I learnt a lot about human beings. I learnt a lot about how the world is, and I don't have a black and white view of the world. I think, you know, the world's got so many facets to it and so many ways to understand it. So I don't regret that. No, not at all.
Rahila, when you were 2 years old, your father decided to dress you as a boy. What's it been like to have such a fateful decision made by someone else?
Yeah, the decision that my dad made at such a young age kind of formed the foundation of who I am as a person now. If I didn't have that experience of living a very free life in a country like Afghanistan where women don't have any rights or have very limited rights, I think my life would be very different. And it definitely set out the way that my life has played out now.
Do you feel like you're a more confident person because of the decisions your dad made for you?
I have been practicing as a lawyer for the past 3 years. I worked extremely hard, went to university, graduated, and then got into law straight away. Oh.
Jerry, you've survived multiple plane, car, motorcycle crashes. You had a run-in with a shark. Have you decided to tread more carefully these days?
Definitely not. Definitely not. It's, look, there's a saying that's been around for a long time that we only live once. That's not true. We only die once. We should live every single day of our life doing whatever it is that gets the blood boiling. As long as you're not hurting anybody else, do everything and anything in this life, because you're better off going to the grave going, did I really do that? Instead of saying, gee, I wish I would have done that.
Adam, your decision to become a vegan led you to Laura. Are there any big decisions left to make?
Yeah. Laura. just based on the wisdom of this room tonight and how much I love you and I love our family and fate or free will or luck. It's definitely luck with you, but would you marry me? Oh,
sorry. Yes. Yes, of course.
I think that's our first Insight proposal. Go, Adam. You've been together for 5 years. Congratulations, by the way. You share four children. Why did you make the decision to propose to Laura now?
I suppose, as I compose myself, the discussions today have been so insightful. Living life to the fullest seems to be a big theme, and that's a theme in our lives. And for us, creating the story of our life for not just ourselves but our children is really important. How we identify with the world and how the world identifies with us is something that we take quite seriously, and that is it, I think. and my immense love for you and our kids.
Love you too, lots and lots.
Well, I can't think of any other way to end the show but on that. So congratulations. Thank you to you for being here. Thank you for your company. You can catch up on this episode or any others on SBS On Demand. I'll see you next time.